project? I mean, this was obviously something that captured the sports nation back then.
I'm very proud of it. Our directors, Aaron Light and Gentry Kirby, did a great, great job with the story. Shaq and Penny are actually executive producers on it as well. Mm-hmm. And it's a fun story about a city that, you know, became a major league town. You know, and I could relate to that. I had grown up in Charlotte when Charlotte didn't have NFL or NBA teams there, and that fight that you have as a citizen of a city to want to see your city become big league. Mm-hmm. And I could kind of even relate to that, how Orlando became big league when the Magic was awarded a franchise.
What was Shaq and Penny like to work with? Because there were times when they got along great and times when they didn't get along great, which I'm sure you...
Shaq and Penny were great on the project from the start. They were a lot of fun. And you'll see the opening to the film and even the closing are a little bit different than what we normally had in our 30 for 30 films. And just we play off the personality of those two. And it's a remarkable story of what they quickly were able to ignite here in Orlando. And it ultimately didn't work out in terms of championships, but it certainly put Orlando on the national map in a hurry.
How did they, as they're looking back on their time, obviously they've been out of the game for a while, how did they look back on their time in Orlando? As, like you said, it was somewhat brief being together, but what did they say as they've seen this city kind of grow up, you know, with them there and now with them gone?
They look back on it fondly, with very, very warm memories of their time together here, and I think with some regret that they wish they would have stayed together and stayed together longer, because they really had something special in the works there, and things ultimately just didn't end up working out. But Shaq certainly seems to regard Orlando highly to this day, and Penny, I think, the same.
What is it about this team? I mean, 20 years later, people around the country still talk about this team. You know, you still see the pinstripe jerseys everywhere. What is it about this team that holds people's imagination still?
I think it starts with Shaq. Mm-hmm. It's young Shaq, right out of LSU, running up and down the court, dominating the way he did, and then Penny coming along. I mean, they were really an equivalent, a younger equivalent even, of Magic and Kareem, what the Lakers were able to do with those two together. And now you could just imagine the possibilities with how quickly Shaq and Penny emerged as top players in the NBA, very quickly. And I think we certainly remember them getting to the 95 finals, and it looked like already they were going to be winning a championship, and then everything turned at the end of game one. And then this guy, Michael Jordan, decided he was, you know, coming back, and while they beat him that first playoff run, but he was maybe a little rusty, and Chicago was just starting to figure it out again with Jordan back. That second year, they went up against the team that still, to this day, still has the greatest regular season record in NBA history. The 95-96 Bulls went 72-10, and now Golden State's trying to equal or top that. That was an enormously, you know, historic Bulls team there. So it's not like Orlando wasn't succeeding. It was working. It was working beautifully. They had put together the team so well with the, you know, classic kind of shooting guard with Nick Anderson, and they draft the small forward, Dennis Scott, who was one of the forerunners of a small forward shooting from three-point territory. They get Horace Grant, like your classic power forward. It was a beautifully stitched together lineup. And, you know, it's really kind of amazing that it didn't fall together the way we all thought it would.
When Shaq came back last year, he said, "Look, big part of me, I wish I hadn't left." Did he convey that to you guys? Did you hear that from him?
We did hear that from Shaq, that he, you know, one of those, if he had to do it again, you know, and he wishes he wouldn't have left. That's no negative statement, I don't think, on Los Angeles. His time with the Lakers was incredibly successful and fruitful for him. But I think with the years gone by and seeing how it unfolded, and there's a big sequence in the film that focuses on how it happened that he ended up going to LA at age 24, I think there's a certain amount of regret that he expresses still. Yeah.
Can we get your spelling of your last name?
Yeah. Yeah, it's John, J-O-H-N. Last name is Dahl, D-A-H-L. And I am vice president and executive producer with ESPN Films. And I oversee 30 for 30, of course.
What was the toughest part of this project for you whenever you do something like this? What was the biggest challenge with this project in particular? Whether it be certain interviews, certain aspects of what message you want to give up with the film?
Well, I think... One, you know, in terms of interviews, it took us a little while before we were able to get to Nick Anderson And Nick is so important to telling the story of what happened at the end of Game 1 of the 1995 Finals. And Nick was in one of our other 30 for 30 films, Ben Wilson, Benji, who was somebody he had a tremendous personal high regard for. So that was one thing. And I think just to explain how it all happened, because there's a lot to take the viewers through. Just first of all, how they got a team, then how it slowly built over time, and then, you know, how Shaq and Penny first became aware of each other through blue chips, and then how the Bulls and Michael Jordan kind of factored into all this, and then what led to it kind of coming undone the way it did. I don't think I understood we embarked on this project. This is a film we wanted to do for a while. We had talked a lot about it a couple of years ago, and then eventually commissioned it. I don't think I understood that Shaq wasn't looking to leave Orlando when he did. Like, initially, I think he wanted to stay, and then it's just a series of events turned the narrative. But it wasn't like he had set out from the beginning, say, I'm leaving for L.A., I'm out of here. And that wasn't the case at all. And at the time, I didn't realize that. I thought he was probably looking to leave L.A. all along.
You talk about looking at this story for a while. What was it about this story that seemed to make it fit for a 30 for 30?
I think what made it fit for 30 for 30 so well is that it's a team that actually was memorable, even though it didn't win a championship. And so you can certainly think about what might have been, and a lot of sports fans like to think about that. But beyond the basketball story, they transcended sports. They made their way into pop culture with Little Penny. Everybody remembers, you know, right away when you talk about, hey, we're doing the 90s Orlando Magic. Oh, yeah, Little Penny. I love Little Penny. And Shaq and all his endeavors off the court that he was doing, from rapping to wanting to, you know, commercials and whatnot. They were able to break through to the more casual fan. And that, for us, is what kind of 30 for 30 is all about, transcending the sports story, touching larger themes.
Thank you, John.
Yeah, very much.